So my 21st birthday, they threw a surprise party for me in my house behind the gates, Westchester County, Woodland Hills. Heather Locklear and Tommy Lee were married at the time. They lived down the street. Scott Baio was a friend. He was there. And I remember going into each room, and in one room were the accountants and the lawyers, well, they were on payroll. Another room were my key employees, they were on payroll. I went to my best friend, I had just given him Z-Best stock, and the only person there that I had not paid was my mom. Even the girl I was with, and she is wonderful to this day, friends, great lady, she's married, doing great, no animosity, amazing woman. But I went around my 21st birthday and said, you know, I pretty much bought, I don't know who loves me for me. And I don't even know if I'm worth loving if everybody were to know the real truth. So when you climb that ladder that leads to the top and you get there, you find out that it's leaning against the wrong wall.
We got Barry Minkow. Barry, thanks for coming through.
Glad to be here. Thanks for having me. Privilege.
Barry, you grew up not too far from here, man. Reseda, California.
Yes. Not too far. We're in Burbank, so went to Cleveland High School, not ZBest first office in the Reseda Business Center on Darby and Sherman Way. So yeah, not far.
Barry, a lot of our audience might skew a little younger and not know you, but I remember growing up in the 80s, ZBest carpet, the scandal around it was the biggest thing in the papers. It made international news. You were 16 when you started ZBest, correct?
Yes. So yeah, I'm 16 years old and not the best looking guy in high school, and had a crush on a cheerleader who was a year older than me. And I had a 1972 Buick I was driving, which they called the bomb because you could hear it before you saw it. You could hear it coming. And nobody wanted to be caught dead in the bomb. So I had been carpet cleaning weekends, summers. My mom was a telephone solicitor for a couple carpet cleaning companies, got me jobs there. So I really kind of learned the industry, how to telemarket to get customers. This is back in the early 80s, late 70s. And so about 1982, I'm just starting 11th grade. I go do a guy I knew from the gym, did his house. He goes, how much would that equipment be? I said, about $1,600. And steamer, shampooer. And he lent me the money to buy my own equipment. And I'm 16 years old, and I opened ZBest in October of 1982. So while I was in 11th grade, just starting, ZBest started out of my parents' garage, pulled out the picnic table, brought in the equipment, did the appointments after school and on weekends, and got notoriety, but that's a whole nother story. But yeah.
That's a great business for it. But so from the gate, you were just this entrepreneurial guy. It was in you.
Yeah. Well, I guess what was in me is kind of a means to an end at the time. I mean, if you ask me at 16, did you plan on by the age of 20 being, a public company on Wall Street, doing an S-1 registration statement, being involved with the mob, two different families borrowing money, lying on my financial statements, defrauding auditors. When I'm in the garage at 16 years old in 1982. And that's a very important point, because I did, 15 years in federal prison on two different charges over time. And everybody I met had one thing in common. None of us ever planned on being there. I mean, there were lawyers there, didn't go to law school, end up in prison. So in like manner, when I'm in the garage in October of 1982, proud that my mother's my first employee and another telemarketer, going to school, leaving them working, I'm not thinking, man, I'm going to end up in the mob, or at least working with them, going public, defrauding Wall Street. None of that. It escalated.
Barry, walk us through really quick. A lot of people know the ZBest story, but you started with some carpet cleaning gear that's a loan given to you by a customer, and then you bought some more gear and you started hiring more guys. Is that how it progressed?
So basically, though, the guy who lent me the money was, I always looked up to him, because got to remember, so 79 and 80, interest rates are what, 20%, 16%. My dad was in real estate. We were broke. So, I mean, our hot water in the house was turned off. We had to call our friends to spend the night so we could take hot showers in the morning, temple handouts. It was bad. So I wanted to, I kind of made a determination that I was never going to let that happen. My dad and mom, great people. No blame. It was bad times. So I went into this business so that I could, you know, generate enough money to not have that happen to me. So the guy who lent me the money, I looked up to. I met him at the gym. He was a loan shark. He was a bookie, and he had a big tool truck, and all of his mechanic people that he sold tools to, he also did bookies with. So he would pull out of his pocket a roll of $100 bills all the time. And I was like, this is my idol, because we didn't have that money. And here I was in a gym in Reseda and befriending him and looking up to him. And that's who lent me the money, but it was $200 a week interest only. So I was doomed to fail when I started. So I was always chasing to pay the interest on the loan after school on weekends, trying to grow the company, thinking the more stores I open, the more revenue I generate, then I could pay the, you know, this loan shark loan off. And it was one bad decision after another, but I refused to quit. Instead of saying, you know, when I'm in 12th grade, it's like, you know, I have two offices, payroll is struggle to meet, I'm having to lie more to kite checks, credit card fraud, I'm all this to cover my expenses. You know, maybe I wasn't ready,
right.
But I refused to humbly say, you know, I failed, and maybe we'll relook at this again a few years from now. I didn't. I just kept pressing through. And
right now, this loan shark guy, do you think in retrospect he was bringing you into deep water? Was that kind of his strategy, or not really? He was
no. You know, in his way, he really thought he was doing me a favor.
Okay.
It's just he never contemplated, you know, a favor would be no interest, right? But he wanted me to succeed, to his credit. I don't blame him. He didn't make me take the money. But when you're a broke Reseda 16-year-old kid getting Temple handouts and you get an opportunity at 60, I've never seen that much money in my life. So I wasn't going to back down. I was going to do whatever I could to succeed. And then, you know what happened? You start getting some success. And then at high school, it's like the parties you weren't invited to, hey, that's Barry the Entrepreneur. And so I got a Diners Club card. I'll never forget this, in the mail. And on Friday nights, I would, after football games, I'd take everybody out to Victoria Station, and I was buying. And I really noticed that when I was buying, there was a direct correlation with being invited to the cool parties with the people that were a year older, and as long as I was buying. So I made an early determination that if I could just keep on buying, people will always love me. So that kind of caused me to kind of like survive at any cost, because I really liked the positive affirmation. I was an acceptance hound. Certainly narcissistic, and it played right into feeding an insatiable appetite.
Define narcissism to me. What is narcissism?
Well, if you look in the dictionary, you'll see my picture under the definition. So narcissistic behavior is behavior that is something I've struggled with through my whole life. So just think of selfishness on steroids.
It's all about Barry Minkow.
It's all about, yeah, and you have a very myopic view of the world. And your care and concern for others is there, so you're not a sociopath.
Okay.
But you just care about you more. So that's...
Would you hurt another person to benefit Barry Minkow?
Right.
And would
then
you, I'm asking?
Justify it, and then you might even try to pay the other person back, but you're always the priority.
Okay. So yeah, that's narcissism
in
the way you understand it and the way it's understood.
Well, selfishness. Yeah, I don't think you'll get too many people that will argue that narcissism intrinsically means... you know, selfishness on steroids.
Would you compare that to egomania? Is it an egomaniac thing? Like it's all, I'm the best. I'm the, you know.
You know, meaning are there any people that struggle with large egos who aren't themselves narcissists? Don't know, not a psychologist. But for me, I was probably both.
Okay.
I could speak to me, but I can't speak to others.
Right. And the money gave you the power. It gave you this.
Right. And the acceptance.
Right.
And it gave me, it was just being accepted. And in those days, you know, you didn't have social media. You didn't have the internet. You didn't have the things that you have to distract you today. It was all about who you hung out with, where were you at Friday and Saturday night. And it was image management at a very young age. And money equaled acceptance. So that I could do. I couldn't be good looking overnight. I couldn't, you know, but I could do the money thing. I couldn't be the star football player on the football team, although in prison I was, but that's another story. But I couldn't do that overnight. But I could do the money thing because I was in a business and I was the only one. You know, there weren't a lot of 11th graders, 12th graders anywhere that you could find that had, you know, 20 employees. in a couple offices and running a
It's amazing. Most kids at 16 are jacking off.
That's what fed my ego, back to your point, to keep it going. I didn't want to fail. So, yeah, I like your tie-in between egotism and narcissism.
Yeah, so you're pumping more and more cash. You're growing this business, ZBest Carpet, and it's becoming a sensation in the Valley, and you're employing a lot of people. Everything, you know, the saying that all roads to hell are paved with good intentions, everything's being paved well, right?
You made a very good point. Don't want to get into anything to do with politics, but for me, I can only speak to this. You just said something very important. The ends justify the means for everybody I ever met in prison, meaning it's okay for me to lie on a bank loan application because I'm going to use the money to meet payroll. And I got all these families that are banking on me, relying upon me. Lying is okay because I have a good cause. Everything is on the table when you're trying to meet payroll, whether it's credit card fraud, borrowing from the mafia, lying to get loans. It all is justified so you could sleep at night because the use of proceeds is to meet payroll, which is going to benefit others. That's the lie we tell ourselves. And you know what? I see this today. It's as long as the cause is okay, however you define okay, then everything's on the table and nothing's really wrong. That's the same prison attitude everybody I met in federal prison for 15 years has. Now you see it today where the ends justify the means. It doesn't matter about X. This guy's crazy. So everything's on the table. So that was the rationale I used.
Absolutely. We all do it, Barry. It's called minimizing, denying, and blaming. We minimize the experience. We deny, you know, we deny it, that it's a big deal, and we blame somebody else, right?
But the one thing you're missing. It's absolutely necessary. That's the key. That's for criminals. That's where it becomes criminal. Meaning I have to meet payroll, so I have to steal money if I have to get it because it's the cause is so important. I can't let families go without.
Sure. You're justifying it by
justifying evil and wrong and crime.
Yeah.
Because of, yeah.
Right. Now, Barry, you mentioned you lied to banks to obtain loans. Wouldn't these banks audit you and go, Barry, you know, you don't have the assets you're claiming, you know, or you don't have, would you fake a purchase order? Is that how you did it? Tell us how.
Well, there was probably some invoice fraud in there, but accounting fraud is, I learned very quickly, and people learn. Einstein said the best experience is when you go through it yourself, right? The best teacher is your own experience. So one of the things that I learned was I went to a bank at 16, 17 years old and said, I need a loan, because obviously I did. They said, well, you need financial statements. I didn't even know what a financial statement was, but you can bet I was a quick study. So I found out somebody who created fraudulent financial statements and got phony tax returns. Remember, this is 82, 83, 84. They couldn't check they didn't have Form 4506. Today, if you submit a tax return that's a fraud, they could find out almost instantly because Form 4506 will verify the return they have with the one filed. And if there's a discrepancy, you're a crook. So, that technology doesn't exist in 82, 83, 84. So I'm submitting tax returns to banks to qualify for loans that none of them were real. So learning to do accounting fraud and then later learning how to fool the auditors, inventory, percentage of completion method of accounting, journal entries, invoicing, manipulating bank statements to make income, kited checks look like income. All these tricks of the trade I learned because I knew if I didn't do it, I wouldn't have the financial statement to get the loan to keep the thing going. So by necessity, I became an expert in accounting fraud only because I knew I needed to get financial statements in order to get loans. So today, what do you see? You see investment, people in charge of private equity funds, what are they doing? Creating phony returns that didn't exist and going to jail because they told their investors they were achieving these kind of returns. They weren't. How did they tell them? They doctored they did what I did. So when you see it every day, I mean, you just Google it. You doctor the earnings. See, all white collar crime is, if you learn anything today, learn this. Lying about what you owe and lying about what you earn. That's all it is. Everybody who's ever been in federal prison for anything white collar, they lied about what they owed, they hid debt, or they inflated what they earned or inflated returns. So that's the whole accounting thing. It became something that I became by necessity an expert in.
And that instant gratification gave you some long-term pain. But when you were doing these frauds and you were lying about what you owed and what you made, did you ever have a self-talk with yourself and say, hey, listen, I've got some banks lending to me. Let me catch up to my own fraud. Did you ever have that dialogue?
See, that's another good point. So everybody who ever perpetrated fraud has what we call the cure. So we have lying about what you owe, lying about what you earn, but we want to sleep at night too. So we have the cure. You know what the cure is? Exactly what you said, and I don't know how you knew it, because, well, maybe you do look a little shady. The issue about the cure is this. I want James Lewis, he's doing 30 years. He was one of the first crimes we had uncovered back in 2003. He had managed a couple movie stars, $300 million. It's a public record. And he had, you know, lost the money, but he had told the investors he had made money. You know what he was doing? You know what he said? I was always one good trading day away from cleaning it all up. The cure. At ZBest, all I had to do was survive until January of 1988. I could sell my free trading shares, get $18 million in equity just by selling a million shares, pay off the Mafia, pay off the Ponzi, go legit. That's why we were trying to buy KeyServe, which was three times our size, with Michael Milken doing the financing. It's the cure. Nobody who does what we do is stupid enough to think they can perpetually get away with it. There's always a cure, but we always don't. And by the way, let's say we get the cure. Well, what's going to happen a year later? Everybody always says to me, well, what if you were survived until January of 88? You could have sold your free trading shares and cleaned it all up. I said, 2 years later, when economic pressure reared its ugly head, I would have gone back to what worked before, fraud, and it was only a matter of time. So it was a mercy killing that I went under when I did. But you see, we want to sleep at night too. We want to think we're good people. So not only do we rationalize lies, I'm meeting payroll, I'm doing a good cause, this guy's evil, they ripped me off, I should have got this loan, but it's worse than that. We actually have a cure that makes it all okay. I may lie to B of it. Everybody lies to the government about how much they make. I'm going to pay the loan back. You telling me it's wrong to ask for a $10 million loan? I'm going to pay it back. I'm not running to Europe. I'm going to use this money to build my business, and I'm going to pay it back. Who cares if I have to lie to get it? That mentality pervades small business, medium-sized business, large business across this country.
100%. And, you know, Barry, tell me, you know, in your guesstimation, how many Wall Street darlings started off as an operation that was kiting and kind of running on loans and finally were able to catch up to a cure? Are there a lot of those stories you think out there? A lot of Barry Minkows that were able to get their free trading,
able to make it to the cure. So I would go back to this. Maybe there are, but it was only a matter of time before they reverted back to the behavior that worked before. Remember, the thing about white-collar crime versus robbing a bank, the consequences immediately follow the action with robbing a bank. You're going to get caught, most likely, or not, but it's you know real quick, or you eventually they track you down. White-collar crime takes a long time. I mean, you got crooks out there that have committed investment fraud that still haven't been sued by the SEC and put in jail by the FBI, but it's inevitable. We have a couple cases right now we're working on that they take forever. Not so with bank armed robbery with a bank or a liquor store. So what I'm saying is it lures the white-collar criminal to relax and let down their guard. Maybe I got away with it. Because the consequences don't immediately follow, it reinforces the behavior, and we do it again. And we do it again. So we got away with it once, as long as we make the loan. I learned. Make the loan payments. Don't give them any reason to look at the account twice. Continue to fool the auditors. Always be on your A game. Make sure you get your clean reviews or audited financials and keep it moving.
Right. We interviewed Mike Dowd from the 7-5 Precinct, New York, the most corrupt cop NYPD ever produced. And he pulled up to the cop station, his precinct, in a brand new $38,000 red Ferrari. And I said, Mike, that's pretty obnoxious. He says he wanted to get caught. He was really crying out for help. Did you have I want to get caught moment during your time defrauding investors and banks and debtors?
Well, certainly not, because there's a couple things. I made decisions when I want to say the mobster's name, but he just got out of prison and he's very much alive, and so is his brother. And I very much liked him. And he handed me $25,000 in a brown paper bag at $1,250 a week interest only in 1985. When I took that bag, my life changed. I knew what I was doing. I had watched on TV that you get money from mobsters. And, you know, I needed money and banks weren't throwing money at 17, 18 year old carpet cleaners with little assets and not a lot of history and still in high school. So I took that money and my life changed. I knew that everything's on the table. The second thing is when I went public with the SEC and signed that S-1 registration statement, you're in a whole new world, meaning it's time in jail. So I never wanted to get caught. I wanted to clean it up and be a hero. I wanted to grow the company. I wanted everybody to get paid back, but I never wanted to get caught because then nobody would get paid back and I'd go to prison. Emphasis on the latter more than the former. So full disclosure. So no, and the people that I ran into that did white collar crime, they were not trying to get caught. They were trying to clean it up so they would never get caught and never do it again. They weren't proud of what they did. They wanted to clean it up, get out of that. And that's every white collar criminal lies to them. You know what? There's an 11th commandment. Thou shalt not deceive thyself. And the greatest thing I ever learned through my entire experience was this. Justifying is just a lying. Justifying is just a lie. I'm only doing this to survive, to meet payroll, to pay off the mob. It's all good. Everybody does it. Nobody's good. Justifying is just a lie.
Right. And speaking of justifying, did you have a CFO that was in cahoots with you that was signing off on these 10Qs and the
My
Ks?
My CFO was clean. It was, full disclosure, because it's in the docuseries. My right-hand man was in charge of the restoration business, which didn't exist. So today you see companies, it's almost funny. Some of the best franchises are companies like Service Master. They do restoration of floods or fires. So we were claiming to do that on buildings that were damaged by water and fire to the tunes of millions of dollars in the mid 80s. And none of those jobs existed. So my right-hand man there was aware of what was going on, but our CFO was not. So he would just ask for documentation on the jobs and accounting. It was kind of the less people that know about the fraud, the better is how I always thought.
Right. And we've talked to Richard Scrushy. I don't know if you remember. Yes. Hell South and that whole thing. And, you know, he used kind of the claim that his CFO would hand him a phone book and he would just sign the signature page, you know, but under the Sarbanes-Oxley Act that, you know, you're responsible if you sign off on those financials, you're.
He was Rite Aid or?
He was Health South.
Health South, that's right, Scrushy, yes. Remember that, back
yeah,
in that.
Yeah, that was a big case.
Early 2000s.
Sure, and you think of Bernie Madoff, and you and I've talked about the Madoff thing, and you believe that he never even attempted to do a cure. He was just gonna ride it till the wheels fall off.
I can't speak for him, but I think that thing got out of hand. That's one of the few cases where that he was so successful at raising money, there was never really any hope of generating enough returns to service that money. But, you bring up a very good point. Look at Rite Aid with Martin L. Grass when he, president, and they had trouble with their expansion. And you know what he said on the record? He said, I got dirty with the books. It was just for that time. And he ended up going to prison. But his story is fantastic because it's a lesson for everybody. Here you have the president at the time of Rite Aid, and they do this expansion. They run into some technical glitches, and he says, I got dirty with the books. He never planned on it, but something came up and he handled it unwisely. So that's why I always try to tell people, don't ever say it can't happen to you because there's always going to be something that may arise that could tempt you into doing it.
100%. Now, Barry, you mentioned the mob, and I know we don't want to mention the maid guy that gave you that brown bag.
Well, I can mention others because they're either deceased or they're not tripping, but him, we haven't spoken. Yeah.
Can you give us, because a lot of our audience knows about the five LCN families. What family were you dealing with, if we may ask, if that's too.
So it was Colombo and Genovese directly and indirectly through people that were connected both in New York and out here in LA. They were responsible for literally helping me go public when I was 19 through a reverse merger. Took a million shares at 5 cents a share free trading. I paid for it. I got 250,000 and the three mob guys, Vigiano, Shulman, Rint, got 250,000 shares each. And then the stock went to $18. I had to sell mine when it was a buck to meet payroll. They did very well. And then, of course, they were shorting it on the way down, which I later found out. So
they made a fortune.
None of them went to jail. I went to trial, got 25 years, didn't testify against the mob.
You could have made a deal with the prosecutors and said, hey, let me go to the Honor Farm for a year and I'll give you the three mafiosis.
Well, it was more than three. And I just, you know what? It wasn't that I was a stand-up guy. It was that I had such a ego at 21 that I thought, well, you know, I'm a pretty good salesman. I could sell a jury. I could beat them. So more than me being a stand-up guy, because when I went to prison, oh, you're a stand-up guy, 25 years, you didn't tell on the mob. I'm like, yeah, but I'm really not a stand-up guy. I just didn't want to go to prison at all. And I thought I could beat the government. And oh, by the way, I happen to be a stand-up guy, but not intentionally. So don't give me more credit than I deserve. I was doing it to save my own skin. So I did go to trial. And that in prison, you're a hero when you do that. So I was in a medium security facility when I first went in, and I had no co-defendants over me. All of them told on me under. All of them made deals.
Yeah, they wanted the big guy, the head of the snake, right?
They got me, and they were right. They didn't lie. They told the truth.
Now, when you were, I believe you were in Terminal Island, right?
How did you know that? I was in the SHU for a year. Funny story about Terminal Island. That's where I met Franzese in the SHU. That's where I met Bo Bennett, and that's how Death Row Records started, but that's a whole nother story. It was like January, and 60 Minutes came out and I was in it, and they were really worried on the yard, and I had turned myself in. Now, I was on steroids at the time and no clothes could fit me.
You were totally jacked.
But not real. It was all fake because of steroids. But I went into prison at 21 and they found some guards' clothes in the vent, like near my bed. So they put us all in the SHU, which is 23-hour-a-day lockdown. And I'm like, I got to get out of here, man. This is claustrophobic. I can't do time like this. So the SIS lieutenant in charge, Navarro, a friend to this day, he was in charge at the time. And I said, I want to try the clothes on. I'm going to show you. They're not mine. I got to get out of here. And I knew they wouldn't fit. Man, I put them on. They fit like a glove. He let everybody else out and kept me in. And we would laugh about it later. They later found that they belonged to somebody who did try to escape. And he copped the clothes. And I was never charged, of course, because they weren't mine. But he would later follow me to Inglewood, and he worked in Unicor. We talked, we laughed about that at the time. But yeah, I went in the SHU. I was there for a year from January until December of 88. And then December of 88, MDCLA opened, and I opened it. I was one of their first bakers at MDCLA. After I had lost my trial in December of 88, I was transferred from Long Beach TI to MDCLA. Wow. And then in June of 89, went to medium security Inglewood. It was a medium at the time.
Right. Now, when you were awaiting trial or during your trial, you were incarcerated. Were you worried that the mob was going to put a hit on
that
you?
That was a big concern that the mob did not know that I wasn't. So it was out there like the LA Times did a story. You can Google it to this day. Police learn how mob moved in on Minkow. And that's when the heat started. So Michael Franzese happened to be in the SHU in June, July, August time period of 88. And we met. And at the time, the girl I was dating and his wife became friends. They would come visit together. And I switched lawyers upon Michael's advice. One of them, Tony Brooklier, whose dad's a mobster. And the other one was David Kenner, who's been my friend for 32 years. In fact, we just spoke today. He's Snoop's lawyer. He got Snoop acquitted. Yeah.
Sure.
So, and Shug's lawyer. So he said, Barry, you got to send a message by the lawyers you have that you're not turning, that you're going to fight the government. Well, Brooklier's dad's a mobster. Brooklier wouldn't rep somebody who was snitching. And David Kenner's a stand-up guy. And Michael sent out the word. So the trial didn't start till like July, August of 88. And he saved my life because he sent the word on the yard. And he's a made guy, Colombo family. And he knew the people I was involved with. And he said, Barry's going to trial, leave him alone, he's not testifying. And it ended up in my trial that the government stuck up for the mob and said they were conned by me, which was partially true, but anyway.
So shout out to Michael Franzese for saving your
saved my life, yeah. And by the way, he is multiple times, he'll tell you, bailed my sorry butt out of problems, one or the other. I'm the little brother he never wanted.
Yeah, no, shout out to Michael. And you know, our hearts and our family prayers are with him and the tragedy he went through with his daughter's boyfriend and that whole scenario.
And his daughter is doing remarkably well with Greg Laurie's church now working there, which is, Greg was amazing to bring her on, and she's flourishing.
Great. That's so wonderful.
Yeah, it is good. Jules. Yeah. Jules. She was the flower girl at 2 years old at my first wedding. Jules. She doesn't remember. I said, you were in Hawaii. You were so cute.
No, that's great. So tell us a little bit about King of the Con and the Discovery Plus series that you're doing.
So it's a 3-hour series. And listen, one of the ethical things that they do through this docuseries process that I learned, and I didn't like it, was you have no creative control whatsoever. And that makes them have integrity in saying that, you know. So there were some things that were on that. For example, my best friend in prison was a guy named Peanut. Little did I know that there was this big conspiracy to say that he never existed, African-American man who was my roommate in prison. So when people watched this docuseries, I would get phone calls say, Barry, I was with you in FCI Inglewood with Peanut for 2 years. And why would they even insinuate that he doesn't exist? So that kind of stuff, like, you know, the problem is you didn't have any gotchas because Barry came out and said, I did it all. Not going to lie about it. Not going to make excuses about it. Justifying is just a lying. This is what I did. Don't follow in my footsteps. The devastating consequences of your children growing up without you will haunt you. Don't follow in my footsteps. Here's the red flags. Here's the slippery slope. Don't go on it. So there was no gotcha moment. So I had to create some. And the biggest, most insulting one was, you know, because Peanut's son is Jamal, running a trucking company, killing it in D.C. One, a good friend to this day on Facebook. It takes about 2 minutes of due diligence to verify that this guy, you know, is real and existed. And yet they carried on like, maybe he does, maybe he doesn't. And I was like, that was kind of very disconcerting. But that's part of not having creative control, and I'm a big boy. There were other inaccuracies, you know, that kind of came to heart. Like, you know, when I went to the church to pastor, loved the church, had a great, wonderful church body, people who believed in me, and I let them down. But, you know, it was years into my stay at Community Bible Church that my first offense occurred, as the government says in their indictment that takes about 2 seconds to Google. The theory was Barry went from one crime and he went to seminary so he could defraud a church. Not the case. I was years into the church before the first crime, according to the government, not me, ever took place. Not nice. Restitution. Paid restitution for years. Well, we didn't get anything. Oh, well, we got the check after the filming. Okay. Listen. I'm a big boy. Whatever I did, I ain't tripping. I'll take it. I deserve it and more. I did 15 years if I would have, you know, so didn't get away with anything. But the point was that don't kind of put stuff on people that's fiction. That's all.
Right.
Happy to own everything I did, and there's that more. And by the way, when I started to complain, you know what Francis said? He goes, listen, you and I didn't get indicted for a lot of things we did do, so don't trip. He was right. You don't want justice. You know, there's a lot of things that I didn't get in trouble for that I probably should have, so I'm good.
It's a really interesting story. Barry, if we were to have an honest appraisal of you at this given moment, is there still a con man left inside you?
Well, I mean, you know, listen, and given the right temptation, you can commit the worst of sins, right? So I find myself, if I'm backed into a corner and she's asked me to do something and I haven't done it, okay, yes, I did, and then I'll go do it to try to cover up. The difference is the proactive, I'm going to work today to lie and deceive people out of their money or to steal this or to do that. That's kind of gone. Reactive, I got a long way to go. And there's a lot of areas in my life that that need improvement to this day. But I don't think felonies is one of them that I have to worry about at this time, but I'm always on guard. And one of the things I've done is I've kept myself out of positions and situations that might lead to. You know, my judge in Miami was Judge Seitz, and I'll never forget, a dear woman. And she doesn't know I know this, but in 2015, she called my counselor at Atwater and said, is Barry doing good? I'm just checking on him. This is 4 years after sentencing. And she said to me, avoid positions of trust for now. You know, you don't want to run a church right now. You don't want to run a company right now. It's going to lead you to make decisions that might, and she goes, here's what you do. You get out of prison, and this is 2011, she said it. Little did she know. You have a knack for uncovering fraud. I got a letter here from the SEC that says you've uncovered 11 cases, $1 billion in fraud, and they're the ones who want you in jail for insider trading. So clearly you have a knack. Why don't you stay away from public companies when you get out and contribute back to society, uncover investment fraud. You clearly have a gift for it. Well, fast forward to 2018, December, I get out. You got social media, wasn't around back then. You got investment opportunities on Facebook and YouTube and Instagram offering guaranteed 20, 30, 35% annual returns. And I just saw this complete, you know, people not doing due diligence, credibility to the investment imputed because they're on Instagram or Facebook, and very little due diligence, and a lot of people buying into it. And I'm like, this is crazy. Radio ads, yes, you can earn 22%. I'm like, 22%? I mean, the mob has trouble with those kind of returns. I mean, it's crazy. So that's when I started to go back into the very private company only, submitting reports to the SEC. So I sent one to my buddy at the SEC. He goes, Barry, we don't do it this way anymore. He goes, it's the Dodd-Frank Act. Now you got to submit it to DC. You're a whistleblower. I said, I don't want a whistleblower. I just want this company shut down. He goes, you got to do it this way. So 12 cases later, two have been shut down. And four under investigation. I expect to be shut down soon, and I'm working on a big one right now. But it's just investment fraud. People pouring their money and their life savings at a time when it's very tenuous right now with inflation. People cannot afford to lose money. And these people are lying about what they owe and lying about what they earn. And it takes somebody who has used the same tactics and techniques to identify those red flags.
That's great,
and
Barry.
Proactively try to uncover it. So that's what we're doing. Yeah.
And that judge gave you some great advice. Take your wheeling and dealing and all that conish narcissism that lives in all of us and apply it towards uncovering fraud.
Yeah, and also the kids, the boys, tragedy. I just want people to know that when you go to prison, your kids grow up without you. And prison is not where you are, it's where you aren't. I left my boys when they were eight. They were holding hands, walking down the street. I'll never forget. I came back and they were in ninth grade, 15. And I'll never get that time back. But one thing, a very good friend, John Whitfield, African-American pastor who married Lisa and I, remarried us, said, Barry, here's the good news. I promise you this. God is outside of time, so he can restore the years that the locust stole. And the last over 3 years with my sons, 3.5 years, have been remarkable, healing. We're a family again. They love their dad. I'm grateful for that. We go to church every Sunday. We do things together. We train together. And I'm grateful for them. And for those people who have failed or who are in prison, there is hope. God is outside of time. So I don't know how he does
it. That's powerful.
But he can bend time in your favor.
That's powerful. Barry, it's so interesting. You know, we all got a front row seat on your journey because ZBest, like you said, you were the OJ for a couple. You were in every media cycle for 2 years in the 80s, in the late 80s. And, you know, to see what you've become now is this fully evolved guy who's very in touch with his own vulnerabilities. And when people hear your story, some may sit in judgment of you, but most people examine themselves. And they look inside themselves and go, what would I do if I was Barry?
So here's the thing. Everybody always says this, and don't miss this. Let's say you're tripping, and you're like, I don't believe this guy is a two-time loser. Although many people I met in prison had been back and forth and back, not tripping. So let's say you're saying, he's a two-time loser. I can't listen to what he says or believe what he says. Well, you're not my people anyway, so I'm not trying to reach you. Here's who I'm trying to reach. If you failed, are an addict, have been in and out of prison, violate positions of trust, burnt relationships, are absolutely lie even when you don't have to, you're my people. You're who I'm trying to reach. You're the ones I love, can connect with, have a message for. Because we share points of similarity in the things that we do wrong, and there's hope. So if you lie, violate positions of trust, addict, in and out of prison, nobody knows the real you, narcissism, you're my people. Those are the people I'm trying to reach. The others who don't have those struggles, I'm not trying to reach them anyway. I'm trying to reach those who are like me, so I have a limited audience that I'm trying to reach, and it's those who have failed, who have no hope, who have been in and out of prison, who violate positions of trust and lie. You're my people. I love you. I stand with you. You can overcome this, and don't listen to the haters. And that's why I did 15 years. So ain't nobody can say I looted a Macy's and got away with it. I did 15 years in prison.
You paid your debt to society, no question about it.
And still pay every month restitution and will for the rest of my life, and I'm not tripping. So for those who have failed, my message is to them, not to those who don't struggle with lying, cheating, drug addiction, in and out of prison, duplicitous life. Those aren't my people. So I don't connect with them, so I'm not trying to reach them.
Right.
So I'm not tripping.
You know, what you're doing for society, beyond the debt you paid with the restitution and the incarceration, you're solving huge fraud cases, and you've solved quite a few big ones. And I guess you could kind of see them, like you could kind of spill the tea to the SEC and let them know these guys are bad, these guys are good. Speak about the stock market itself. Is it just a rigged gambling table? Is that really what it has become?
You know, one of the most stunning things that ever happened was that Reddit thing with the
AMC movie theaters and GameStop. Yep.
So that really, for me, I think for the public, opened the eyes that these institutions corner the market. There is some, you know, while the SEC does its best to have a level playing field, it is a zero-sum game.
Are you allowed to play the market?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Not only am I allowed to listen, you want to hear something funny. Judge Seitz had no problem with me opening up a trading account the day I got out, but I couldn't pastor a church for 3 years while I was on probation. You will not go near. She was a Christian, so she's like, you can't pastor. It's in my judgment and consent. It's a public record. I had no preclusion from trading or being have a trading account. It was, I couldn't pastor a church for 3 years. Not that I, you know, am either qualified nor want to. But the point is I think here's the problem. It isn't necessarily Wall Street. Here's your problem. People do more due diligence in the produce section of their supermarket, differentiating between a ripe banana and a non-ripe banana, than they do when they take their entire life savings and throw it into some deal, Wall Street included. You would be surprised how little it takes to separate people from their money, and perpetrators know this. They know just what to say, when to say it, and they are experts at separating you from your money with fake promises, high pressure, and you know, there's one particular company, I certainly won't mention their name. It is absolutely ironic. They say they generate these returns, a billion-dollar company. So you ask them for financial statements. Guys, if there's one thing you do when you go into investment, you want something that we call independent proof of profitability, meaning I could say, hey, you invest with me, you're going to get a 30% return. Well, who says? Well, here's my financial statements. They say it, and they're audited by that's better than nothing. But if you don't have any way to independently prove, other than the promoter, that return, run like heck. You got people. I people call me. I'm like, did you get financial statements? Well, no, I talked to my buddy Jim, and he was getting his returns, so that was good enough for me. So this is the helping people understand that when there's a wall erected between you and due diligence, it's a red flag for fraud. At the restoration jobs, they would say, Barry, we want to visit these restoration jobs. They didn't exist. So what I would say is, well, no unauthorized people are allowed at the job site at any time because of liability. Oh, okay. What was the real truth? They didn't exist. So when there's a wall erected, that's a red flag. Don't invest. I'm telling you right now, it's being lost in COVID. It's been lost in the war in Ukraine, tragic as that is. The victim impact of financial fraud is larger than you can ever imagine. And it's only because the SEC is so hopelessly overwhelmed and understaffed that they're not able to prosecute and shut down these. That's why you can't rely on the government. You got to be sharp yourself. money is easy to give, hard to get back.
Right.
So you want to be very careful because we have an overwhelmed SEC that could barely keep up with all the fraud that's happening. Look at how many, what is it, one-third of the PPP money was a fraud? Come on.
You think
fraud is compartmentalized?
No.
Listen, if you lie in one area, you're going to lie in another.
Barry, crypto, good or bad?
I had a buddy named Julian, my training partner in prison, and he's like, I got a crypto card. It's got like, he was a Bitcoin guy with, he was a part of that website and that whole thing where the guy got life. Here's the problem. The only asset class that's doing any good right now appears to be the dollar. I mean, with the market pulling back, I think the dollar's up like 8.3 or 8.5%. And crypto's just like, you know, as the time of this filming, it's taken a hit. Now, it hasn't taken 80 to 90% hit. Do I think in the future, I'm worried about the regulation of crypto and Bitcoin. I'm worried about that they just...
Is no regulation?
I'm worried that, well, yeah, but I'm also worried that the government, the SEC appears to be saying we want to call it a security. That's a... You know, easy entry, this monetary system that is supposed to be separated from government, now being smothered with potential bureaucracy and restrictions is probably spooking some people. Also, the money that you used to have, dispensary income, when inflation is eating up, so they're pulling it out of the stock market, pulling it out of Bitcoin. So in the future, perhaps right now, it's scary.
Barry, how do we get ourselves out of this inflation? How do you mop up this liquidity? How do you cure inflation? Is there any cure for it? Because everything seems so much more expensive now.
I was at a gas station, and Channel 5 News arbitrarily picked me. Like, they come up with these cameras. They didn't know it was me or anything. And they go, what are you doing? I said, well, this gas thing just asked me for my FICO score because, and they laughed. And she goes, well, what do you think of this rebate that Governor Newsom in the state of California is wanting to give? You heard about it, the $400 or whatever it is, and I guess it's delayed. You heard about it. So here's the thing. Don't really want the rebate, but if you look at California as the highest taxes on gas, how about pull back some of them taxes that are only in our state and not in others? That would help the consumers over a sustained period of time. And this taxation thing is just, I don't think you can tax your way out of inflation. I think it's a very difficult time. Monetary policy, listen, for any perpetrator of fraud, the monetary policy of the U.S. government for the last 3 years is like a case study. Don't have it? I do now. I mean, you don't even have to print it. It's digitized. So the monetary policy of this country puts some of the accounting frauds to shame, including my own. And it's scary because, you know, that's going to catch up with you, right? So I think the scares of inflation are very much real, and the only way, as you know, is the painful time of sucking that money out of the system by higher interest rates, and that's going to have repercussions. So, very scary time. Hey, all the more reason why you can't afford to lose your money in some fraudulent investment. All the more reason.
And thank God you're scanning the NASDAQ and the NYSE and all these exchanges for those frauds, and we commend you for that. Thank you for doing that and applying your knowledge to the good hats, the white hats, so to say. Now, Barry, in every faith, your body's your temple, and you've already taught us so much about fitness and keto dieting. Tell us a little bit about how you maintain your ripped physique, man. Are you a keto guy? Are you a primal guy? Atkins?
Yeah.
What's
yeah,
going
no, no,
on?
No. So listen, I have a very good friend named Damien Law. He's African-American. He's my hero because he was a gang leader in Oakland, drug dealer, went to Bible college, got out early, 7 months early, is going to be a pastor, and he's an amazing guy. We dieted in prison and worked out in prison together. And he made a statement one time. He goes, Barry Minkow succeeds because he's still in prison. And he goes, what I mean by that is that the institutionalization of structure that was prison, you eat at a certain time, you go to bed at a certain time, you're locked down at a certain time, whatever. I functioned best there. I got my master's degree, I got a doctorate degree this last stint in prison, earned. I have an unearned honorary, but I also have an earned. And I functioned well under structure. So what I did is, and what Damien always teaches, you took prison home with all the good ways, meaning structure. So some of us need structure to succeed, and there's nothing wrong with it. I'm not talking about institutionalization. But for me, I got to go to bed pretty much at the same time every day. I got to wake up pretty much the same time. I just function better. I'm more focused. No time to let my mind wander. And training is a huge part of it, because the discipline of not only does it give you respect with other men, right, but my sons. My sons watched me December 18 when I got out, and I said, I've got a diet, whatever. They're like, yeah. They've never seen me cheat in 3.5 years, other than my Sunday cheat day for 8 hours, ever. Never miss workouts. Discipline. They've joined me. So
are you an early riser?
I get up very early, like prison.
Like what time?
Like about 3:45, 4. Used to be in prison, 3:20, when the 3 o'clock count was over. I was on the treadmill by 3:20, the only one. And it was indoor at Atwater. So I wanted to keep a close structure where I was the diet, the exercise, so that I succeed. I can't explain it. Does it make any sense to you?
It makes total sense. Structure, discipline.
It helps me.
It helps you. Yeah.
But left on my own.
You're a rolling stone.
Correct. I'm not good. So the structure of my work schedule, workout schedule. So the diet is, I look at Terry Crews, and Michael Hearn's a friend, but Terry Crews, I look at him and I'm like, what does he do? Keto. And he does intermittent fasting. And I'm like, he's in his 50s, I'm in my 50s. So I do keto, intermittent fasting. I stop eating at 2 o'clock. And my kids, if they saw me eating at 3 o'clock, they'd be like, what the heck is the world? Just don't do it.
You've done the movies. We've done the Discovery series. But you need your own television show. Is that something in the works? The Minkow Hour, the Barry Minkow show?
So what is it in the works? I was pitched on Convict Court, where I'm the judge, and I know the law because I've broken them all, and do like a court show where
that's
you're
cool.
The judge. I thought that was cool. But I like the whole concept of like a fraud hour. I don't think it's ever been done. I think kind of like sports became a 24-hour, who would have thought, the subject matter. Deeper than sports is a topic of fraud. It affects everybody at every level. It could be done in an entertaining way. And
I've been talking. That's a great idea.
To interviewing some of the ex-cons. All of us had one thing in common. What was the thing that caused us to go from legit, why we got our degrees, why we went into business, to shift into fraud? What was the trigger? I think that's a captivating story.
It is.
And since you got a million of them, you have a million captivating stories about, well, I couldn't meet payroll. Well, I got injured and they didn't pay my claim. So I felt like, I mean, you wouldn't believe the reasons people who were the most legitimate that I met in prison that went into a life of crime because of something upset the balance in their life and they made a bad decision.
Right. And you've said the skin of truth is wrapped in lies, right?
Yeah,
and
that's what fraud is. The skin of the truth stuffed with a lie.
Stuffed with
a lie. ZBest really did do carpet, furniture, and drapery cleaning with 1,400 employees in 23 locations. Skin of the truth. Stuffed with a lie, $50 million worth of restoration jobs that didn't exist. We got the auditors and lawyers to do all the due diligence here and hid this here.
I have a friend who got really deep into all the conspiracies of the world. And years ago, he was telling me about this island that British royals and presidents would go. And there was a pedo island of pedophilia and little boys and girls. And I kind of rolled my eyes. Yeah, right. But sure enough, the Epstein Island, you remember the Epstein thing? That came up. And I was like, wow, this really does happen. So again, there's this skin of truth. But there's some exaggerations, and I don't believe there's these tunnels, and they're drinking the blood. I don't know. You could go on and on with it, but the point of the matter is, you have really changed the way you see the world. You've given back. Now it's time for Barry Minkow to have his own television show that talks about fraud. I think you need to do it, and we could discuss off camera how we can work together on that.
Yeah, entertaining, funny, guest-driven, on the street, asking people, do you understand, what would you do before you invested in something? Boom, and listen to the answer. You wouldn't believe the material, the current events, the number of people that, go look at Smart News, how many people are in jail for a white-collar crime every day. I do. And you wouldn't believe the number of people that commit fraud. And I'm not just talking about PPP and EIDL and all the recent COVID frauds. I'm talking about, it's an epidemic proportion investment fraud more than ever. And nothing's being really entertainingly, is that a word, done about it. And I think it could be done funny, relevant, So we're thinking about that. Yeah.
And Barry, you know, you dedicated your life to fitness, and you like I said, you've educated us about, you know, the keto and the intermittent fasting, having a feeding window, and
listen. Remember, I was addicted to OxyContin, so you need to know the full disclosure. I was a pastor of a church, secretly addicted to Vicodin, OxyContin, and steroids at the time, and abusing. So I was living a double life, and it was very detrimental to my health. So there's one thing that when I got clean and sober, you know, 11 years ago, that I decided, and that was, if I could hold the line at health, I'll never digress back into drug addiction, and that my health is a priority. And so that was, of course, all the spiritual reasons why, you know, drugs are wrong and lying and living, all, of course. But for me, that was a big booster, that life felt so much better off drugs, off Oxy, off Vicodin. There is hope. Natural endorphins do happen when you do cardio and weights and diet over a sustained period of time. And life is just more enjoyable. So the other thing, in prison, if you lifted heavy and you did it, and I dieted, I ate tuna, mackerel. I was the only guy on a keto diet in prison. Who's stupid enough to do that but me? And I did. But the guys respected that discipline, and then it gives you open doors to relationships. You know, you're on the yard, you're lifting heavy, you're you know, it was helpful. So that kind of discipline, I think, is part of sobriety, right? It's part of a healthy balance of life. And for those of us who, you know, like you said, the body's a temple of the Holy Spirit, got you. Certainly that means the spiritual is the priority. But I'm going to tell you something. We have a lot more credibility in this world as Christians if we're fit. I mean, you know, we're upset about this guy's pornography addiction, and meanwhile we're gluttons, right? So I'm careful not to be hypocrisy.
Sure.
Yeah.
No, that's a big thing. Barry, walk us through your morning routine. You wake up at 4. Do you typically meditate? Do you journal as you wake up?
So no, I wake up and I slam the ghost drink, man. That's the pre-workout drink, because I know I got to go do cardio or I got to do train. So I get the training done first, then come back and do devotion.
So you do a pre-workout drink and then you hit some...
So my pre-workout drink is crazy, just so you know. It's a ghost. And then I have separately a keto Elevate, because our friend is in keto, along with a little coffee. And then... water, and then go do training, and then come back and have the protein. So I'm fasting cardio, not intending to, and something, for example, Michael Hearn would be detrimentally against. But for me, listen, I weigh 185. My body fat's about 10-9%. For a 56-year-old guy, I can't, carrying 300 pounds of muscle or carrying 300 pounds of fat, it's obviously better muscle vascular-wise, but it's still 300 pounds on your heart. This age of my life, there are guys, and I'm not a hater. I love bodybuilders. They can do what they want. But for 56, lean.
That's where you want to be.
You want to stay. Yeah. You
don't. Our heroes aren't looking too good.
Right. In prison, it was like we tried to squat heavy and I got arthritis. So, you know, in prison, you're on the yard. You got to put. Listen, 56 years old, training consistently. Cardio is good. Obviously, I do it for health, not for weight loss. I do it because I want to have a heart health,
right.
Weightlifting and the diet. Diet is 85% of it. It's the hardest part, but once you get used to it,
right.
You can do it, get a partner, get accountable, and you'll love the results. But you get on something you can live with.
Right. And you mentioned the intermittent fasting. It's become a big thing. So you're feeding windows from 6 a.m.
to 2. Now, remember, 95% of people we discussed fail on a diet. So remember, I want to increase those odds, right? So I don't want to call it a diet, lifestyle change, something you can live with. And it's a lot of pre-prep. Like I do my vitamins. I take them in the morning and night. I have to put them in foil a week in advance or I wouldn't take them. It's a schlep. If you don't prepare to succeed, you'll fail. So I bring my food with me. I have my, he has the keto cookies. That's your snack, your protein drink, your salad.
But aren't you starving at like 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock? Yeah. You're not hungry yet in the evening?
The first year, maybe, but the one thing I like about keto is, why are you doing it now? We don't need to lose weight. Because it keeps my insulin level down.
Okay.
Which keeps my hunger down. Which also is very good for my glucose. When I get tested, it's 80.
Right.
And 100 is diabetes. So it's for me. I'm not saying it's for everybody, and I'm not a physician, but it works for me because it keeps my appetite suppressed. I'm not trying to be 230 full of muscle winning the Olympia.
Sure.
I'm at 185, 186, fit, and lean. Just want to be 10% body fat and be able to have great cardio so I can run with the kids and keep up with them, squat, do all that stuff, agile. So, but it's the at my age, diet is at least 85% of it. No, it is. And proper supplementation and...
God, Barry, your life, I mean, it's just filled with so much experience and there's so much we could learn from you. And we thank you for coming on the show today and sharing those experiences. How can our audience reach out to you? Do you kind of interact with some of your fan base or your followers, so to say?
Yeah, I do. The best way would be just I'm on Instagram or Facebook under my real name, Barry Minkow. You could just shoot me a note. I'd be more than happy. I do respond to everybody that writes.
That's great, man.
And I'm grateful. And the audience, I tell you, it's been very, I'm very humbled and grateful for the people who have been so forgiving and kind, especially my former church. Many people from the former church are friends to this day. Former leaders reached out in love and forgiveness. And to me, that really helped because they were really the number one victims of my criminal behavior.
Right. And forgiveness is something that I think is one of the biggest forms of gratitude as a human being we can do is to forgive. And the fact that you are thankful for that and you know, no one, Barry, no one that walks this earth can ever throw a stone at you because we all live on our own glass houses, if that makes sense. And you've allowed us to examine our own self. Would we, you know, how would we have conducted ourselves at 30 if we had a publicly traded company? I know what I'd do. I'd be crazy. But that's a whole other story. But Barry, we want to thank you for coming by today.
Honor. Thanks for having me. God bless you, Doris. Thank you.